Okay, welcome everyone to the Electrical and Computer Engineering Colloquium. It's a pleasure to introduce Professor Nadya Peek, Assistant Professor in HCDE here at University of Washington. Nadya and Matt Reynolds and I are academic siblings. We all had the same advisor at MIT, so small world. It's a pleasure to have her here today. She develops unconventional digital fabrication tools, small-scale automation, network controls, and advanced manufacturing systems. Her group here at UW is called Machine Agency. She advises a diverse crowd on manufacturing and making, including the White House Office of Science and Technology Policy, I guess former NASA Ames, the Shenzhen Mayor's Office, Moog Aerosystems, and Jeff Koons. She's an active member of the global Fab Lab community, plays drum machines and synths in the band Construction, and got her PhD at MIT in the Center for Bits and Atoms. Welcome, Nadya.
Thanks, Josh. Hi, everyone. So I'm in HCDE, and today, since this is the ECE colloquium, I tried to dig up some maybe slightly tangential stories about production in electrical engineering. So I don't do electrical engineering research, but I do make a lot of circuits. And I wanted to start in Shenzhen. A lot of people think of Shenzhen as like this hotbed of electrical production. iPhones are made there, many other cell phone products are made there. And I collect these cell phones, which maybe some of you guys have seen around, these Shenzhen phones, like tiny fake iPhones, or phones that are made like Hermes handbags, or this one, which is like a Porsche key phone that you can have two SIM cards in and you can change the battery of. That's also a necklace. And there, I kind of like these a lot because none of them are made to be as popular as the iPhone 11. Like, none of them are made in quantities of millions. They're all made in these volumes of maybe 10,000, and yet they bring together a bunch of different manufacturing types. Like, you have to make the circuit board. This one has like leather rework and a die-cast body. The iPhone runs Android, but it's skinned, like there's software engineering being done here to make it look like iOS. And all of these different production techniques are possible to do together because they're all co-located. You can say, hey, like I have this chipset and it's going to be running this kind of OS and I want the OS to be branded to be Hermes OS or Disney Pig, Dull Pig OS. And all of those things can come together in a really fast way because they're all close together. And you get a different kind of consumer experience walking around in the Shenzhen markets because it's not just these kinds of cell phones that you can get, which you just have to kind of browse around to figure out what even is available. But you can also buy all of the parts. You can get any of the parts of the phone as well as any of the accessories that you might need with the phone, packaging supplies, batteries, and there you can also start customizing things that you might want your phone to do. So if you want a Hong Kong SIM as well as a mainland China SIM, then both of those things can go into your device at the same time. Or you can be a different kind of consumer. The way that you use your device is very malleable. It's not, now we're all going to use Face ID, or now we're all going to adhere to this one particular hardware standard. And if you go out further in the marketplace, you can start buying all kinds of other components too. And there, you know, if you want a potentiometer with an RGB LED in it, and it has like 10K of resistance, and you need 5K of resistance, it literally takes the minutes to switch them all out for you and give you something in a volume of one, a volume of 10, or if you really need it, a volume of 1 million. And as you zoom out from that space, this is just the Huangcheng Bay area. And then as you zoom out in that space, this is just a Google map search of the word factory in the area around Shenzhen where Hong Kong comes down here. So what does this kind of production landscape mean for us now? Like, what does designing electronic devices mean where you can really quickly iterate and build very different kinds of and build really different kinds of products. Now, the week after I defended my PhD, maybe 2-3 years ago, they asked me to teach a workshop where we're going to build a bunch of different machines in Shenzhen. And I didn't really have time leading up to the workshop to prepare because I was working on my defense and it was kind of stressful. And so I gave them a spreadsheet of all of the parts that I needed and the tools that I would need to be able to run the workshop. And I showed up only to find that they just completely misunderstood what I needed. There were no parts, there were no tools, there was nothing. And they were like, but this definitely has to happen because the mayor of Shenzhen is coming. And if you don't pull it off by the end of the week, everyone is going to get fired. It's going to be completely terrible. You have to figure it out. And I was like, well, that sucks. But at the same time, if you're in this area, that's maybe the best place that this kind of problem could happen to you. Like, well, maybe I can. I don't have any of the boards I need, I don't have any of the parts I need, I don't have any of the tools that I need, but I can just walk around and maybe get all of them. So we started this crazy adventure in which, so we needed to build mechanical parts and a circuit board that was going to do the controlling of the machine. So we first bought a reflow oven. We bought a bunch of different components for the boards. We started cutting down the stock and asked different trade show vendors if we could use their equipment. So we just showed up and said, hey, you know, does that laser really work that well? Can we use it to make approximately 60 machines in the next 2 days? We designed, because we weren't sure how to get injection molding done that fast, we designed the bearings so that we could 3D print them. We also 3D printed them all in, on vendor showcase machines. This one I think is also particularly fun. You can get a stencil in less than 24 hours in Shenzhen, and you can buy solder paste, and your solder paste will come in the metal that all girls like, Tiffany. and so I think that it took us maybe 2.5 days to buy the tools and to get the stencils and to get the circuit boards. And then we didn't really have budget to buy our own pick-and-place machine, and we couldn't get a pick-and-place to use that quickly. So we were doing all of the pick-and-placing ourselves manually and reflowing in the lobby of the hotel that we were staying in. We recruited some of my former undergrads who happened to live in the area to come in and perform quality control and testing. So for every circuit board, we had to make sure that they ran the motors correctly and they had to be flashed with firmware, and then we had to make sure that it actually performed to spec. And then we set up a whole production line to get all of the boards done. And then by the end of 5 days, we did have all of the machine body parts and the circuit boards ready to go for the workshop. Unfortunately, and this is maybe since a lot of you might be graduate students or undergraduates, when your advisor asks you to do something completely unreasonable, like build hundreds of circuit boards in a week, and you do it, they're not going to be that impressed with you. So that's the moral of the story is, maybe I should have slept more in graduate school. Now, what is the thing that we were making? Just to give you guys an idea, here what we're interested in is, how do you build machines really quickly, and can you make machines something that you can make as playfully as the phones that I was showing you before? And one crucial component of that is controls for machines that are reconfigurable also have to be reconfigurable. So designing a new board and building the new board every time you change your machine isn't feasible. So how do you do networked controls? This is not necessarily popular among a lot of machine controllers, because every time you add a connection point, you add a point of failure. But it does allow for a lot of flexibility and reconfigurability. This one has sound. And so this was the workshop that we were teaching. So here's an overview of the kit and the reconfigurable machine parts. So it's a laser cut body where each degree of freedom is represented by one stage, and the stage can and the stages can be clicked together into different machines, and the machines could have 1 degree of freedom or 2 degrees of freedom, etc. Because you're using the precision of the laser cutter, so the laser cutter is already trammed and square, you can build really precise things, frames for your machine by taking advantage of the precision of the laser. We taught this workshop also in Fab Academy, which is the global version of the class How to Make Almost Anything, a digital fabrication class. And there, these are all not even necessarily engineering students, but students who are interested in using digital fabrication facilities and wanted to experiment with machine design and machine building. And I guess the takeaway from this is when you write software, you make a really small minimum viable thing before you iterate and build something bigger. Whereas when you build hardware, you often spend months in CAD before and then start building the thing that you're making. And it doesn't allow you necessarily to reflect a lot on, you know, is this actually going to work well for the user that I have in mind? What exactly is the task that I'm trying to automate? And how much precision do I need? Do I need it to actually go really fast? Do I need it to be, this one is really not very precise. This one I think is quite funny. It has a it is able to move the cucumber back and forth and cut it, and yet the part where they really failed was where they attached the knives, so the students had some shortcomings. But yeah, I mean, these machines are basically quite frivolous, but they also took less than a week for people with no prior experience to put together. So if you're thinking about prototyping in electromechanical systems, what is the infrastructure that enables that kind of playfulness? How do you allow for low volume production, not just in things that are not technically complex, but things that might require a lot of subsystems to work together well, but don't necessarily need the speed and efficiency of mass manufacturing? Two different groups this year made sand gardening machines. Turns out that if a machine does the sand gardening for you, it is also a path to Zen enlightenment. So the low volume production of machines and the low volume production of these cell phones, it's something I want you to think about sort of next to each other. If you think about who's making stuff like this, and it's frivolous and sort of, each one is kind of silly, and who's making things like those cardboard machines, and how is the landscape of manufacturing and production changing going forward, and as you guys go out into the world, who are you designing for, and how quickly are those things changing? And if those things are changing very quickly, what are the tools that you need for designing, testing, and producing the hardware that you're making? Now, back in history, a lot of the times people like to think of fabrication as a possible way, as going to follow the same thing that happened with computers. So, you know, here's what the ENIAC looked like in 1946, and here we have the same computational power in a cell phone that's made to look like a handbag. And there is like an imaginary that is popular where we're gonna go from industrial fabrication to personal fabrication in the same way that we went from mainframe computers to personal computers. In fact, mainframe computers were designed at approximately the same time as our first digitally controlled fabrication equipment. And that kind of story is really very popular in popular science description, where you have Matt, Josh and I's former advisor, Neil, who's talking about how personal fabrication is the next killer app for computers, or how the result of being digital is that anyone can make anything anywhere, and even that the author of the guy who wrote The Long Tail, where we're going to start creating smaller volumes for more markets, is also saying that makers are the new industrial revolution. You guys are all going to go out and change what the manufacturing and consumption landscape looks like. And I think a lot of that story is based on a history of science fiction, like the Star Trek replicator. You're just going to walk up to something, and it's going to give you what you want. If you guys have read The Diamond Age, everything is going to be matter compilers. And we're not really even going to think about what we want or how we want it. It's just going to be like automatic, and it'll infer the constraints and the functions that we need to resolve. And I would say that maybe the hype cycle for the maker revolution is not as hot as it was before, but it's still, there's still a lot of spaces like this. At UW, we have Fluke Makerspace and the mill. You guys use the mill? Nobody? You use the mill? One person, that's it. You guys can use the 3D printer as much as you want. If you go up to spaces like this, you can get machines like this little milling machine that helps you cut circuit boards. And all of these are several orders of magnitude cheaper than their industrial counterparts were, or even things were 10 years ago. But you can't necessarily make all of the things that you want. You can't necessarily go to the mill and make those Shenzhen cell phones. At some point, really want there to be some kind of personal fabrication device. This is a This was a briefcase manufacturing center where we imagined if fab labs are mainframes, then what does a laptop look like? And so can you have a folding machine that you can carry around with you that is a 3D printer and a milling machine and a vinyl cutter and perform a lot of the functions that you would otherwise see in a makerspace? But ultimately, you can only make small plastic things with this machine. And then you can maybe make some single-sided circuit boards and maybe some stickers, but this is actually very limited. A personal computer, even the one that you have in your pocket, is maybe going to calculate something much slower than a supercomputer would, but you're still going to get the same answer. If I use this machine, even though I like it a lot as an object, I'm not actually making things that are functional or useful. They might be prototypes. So here's a different machine, a machine that we didn't really get that much attention for at all, but did something much more useful. We needed 58 identical, we wanted to make 58 identical electromagnets, and therefore we wanted to coil this enameled wire along these screws. And we didn't have a coil winder, which I'm sure at ECE you must have hanging around somewhere. And so we made really quickly a machine out of laser cut plastic with two stepper motors and a very simple drivetrain to be able to make these coils. And the thing that we needed was precision. We couldn't wind them by hand because we needed them all to be within 1 or 2 ohms of each other. But the thing that we didn't really need was speed. We only need to make 58 of them, so it was okay if the machine wasn't the fastest thing ever. We didn't need durability, because it wasn't like we're going to use this machine forever, so we could just use this and then if we could take it apart and reuse the different components. And we also didn't necessarily need it to, have dedicated controls. It was okay for us to write software on our laptops, use our laptops to run this machine, and then use our laptops for something else. And so in my research group now, what I'm really interested in is what allows for you to use precision as a creative tool. How do you have access to the precision of machines, but apply it to the creativity of individuals and enable this kind of low volume production, fabrication, weird fever dream, cell phone, techno daydreaming? And one of the major parts of that, I think, is open source hardware. Open source software, I'm sure you're all familiar with, basically runs on any computer. Anyone can take a piece of software and then run it, even if you have to run it in a virtual machine, you can run it somewhere else. And open source hardware isn't necessarily the same as that, because most of what I did in that crazy week in Shenzhen was sourcing, checking, quality control. And so the distribution and replication of open source hardware actually is super different from open source software. And maybe it looks really different also when you're doing it. So here's a machine that I've been working on with a makerspace in Norway, where it's kind of like the cardboard machine kit, except that the drivetrain is entirely made out of it's made out of rack and pinion. So instead of using motors with lead screws, where you have to have an assembly, the rack and pinion is milled in a milling machine that you might have access to in a makerspace. And the geometry for the rack and pinion is optimized for not grinding, which is sort of a traditional way to make gears, but for milling. And that allows you to create a drivetrain of any length, so whatever length machine you want to make. And it also lets you make something really quickly as long as you have access to the right kinds of tools. One thing that is, this is a machine that we made with those axes, and they're also, another thing you might want to change with machines that you're running in this way is you don't necessarily need really high speed tool paths. So I don't necessarily, if I'm cutting steel, which is a hard material, I don't necessarily have to cut it in straight lines. I have enough time to do a trochoidal milling path where I'm always only maintaining one flute of an end mill in contact with the steel at a time. But I'm doing all of this extra movement. So instead of moving in a straight line, I'm doing all of this extra movement to make sure that nothing ever gets hot except for the chip that is being cleared and pushed away. So you can see that the chips get really hot because they've turned blue. But we're not even using any coolant in milling the steel. So there's kind of a combination of things going on there where you want to be able to make really precise and stiff things with materials that otherwise would be difficult to put in a MakerBot. But you do have more time than maybe someone who has to build thousands of cars a day or whatever the mass manufacturing application is. And so what are also the ways in which controlling machines look different when you're working in this new manufacturing landscape? And what is the software that we need for that? Historically, each one of the steps that you undertook when you were doing something with digital fabrication was its own field. So, you know, figuring out how to do computer-aided design was a field, and figuring out what controls were for those kinds of machines was its own field. And every time you translated from one of these fields to the next, there was like a bottleneck, and you couldn't necessarily, you know, there was like meetings with teams that came to agreements. And nowadays, this doesn't really apply anymore. You can become an expert in controls, but if you're doing the end-to-end pipeline, you really need to know all of these different things. And some of those things can easily get abstracted away for you, like doing the comms and controls for 3D printers are typically already encapsulated on the board that's running the 3D printer. But you still have to know how to slice your part, and you still have to know how to design your part. And you have to sort of do those things while understanding all of the other things in that pipeline. If you have a deep understanding of all of those different parts, then you can start realizing that there's a lot of people available that will do different parts of this process in a contract sense. Have you guys heard of the open source hardware laptop? No. Well, there's an open source hardware laptop called Novena. It's very good for programming FPGAs. How long do you think it would take you to design a laptop? In, like, let's call it person years. How many person years does it take to design a laptop? No random guesses? You can just say something. 10 years. OK, so say 10 years. So that's actually a pretty good guess. So if you want to, if you're Dell and you want to release 10 laptops a year, then you need to have lots of engineers that are working on those laptops so that at least 10 on a team, for example. They probably have a lot more. But Bunny and Zobs worked on Novena for approximately 5 years, but there were two of them. And I guess 20 years ago, it wouldn't necessarily be feasible, because every time you would release a laptop, your processors were getting faster and faster. And if you spent 5 years developing a laptop with a particular chipset, by the time you were done with it, it would be outdated. But that's actually, Moore's law doesn't really apply anymore. The things that are changing are in different spaces, like people care a lot about GPUs or parts of their memory or what kind of memory they have. So it is now feasible for two people to spend 5 years developing a laptop and making sure that all of the different components of that laptop adhere to their values. So in their case, they were interested in things that were verifiable, and they were interested in functionality that was specific to FPGA development. They are also interested in having extensibility and reconfigurability of their hardware, because they understood that maybe not everyone was using the laptop for exactly the same purposes as they were. And so I actually work with them on creating this expansion pack area, where if you wanted to add more circuit boards to the laptop that were to do different things, somebody used it, for example, to create a network analyzer out of the laptop. If you wanted to have different functionality, that was already built into the hardware. And so it's not just open source in that you can read the source, but it's open source in that the intention is for you to take it and adapt it and use it for different kinds of purposes. And the reason I think this is really interesting now is because it's possible. I think that even maybe 10 years ago, this kind of project was not feasible, because as an individual, you're not allowed to buy things in volumes of 10. You're not able to get anyone to take you seriously if you called them and said, hey, I would like to buy 15 potentiometers. And now all of those things are different. You really can perform all of these roles as one person or as a small team. And that's really drastically going to change how we build things and who we can build things for. Suddenly, markets that previously would have been considered really too small now are really within reach, because the amount of R&D time that you have to put in before you take advantage of it is completely different. Now, what does it mean, though, for something to be fabricatable? I'm interested in infrastructure that people can reuse for their own purposes, but what does that mean? What makes it easy for people to use designs that we produce? And one of the realizations that I had with PopFab, the briefcase machine that you can use for lots of different things, is even though I made that open source, no one successfully replicated it. You needed to have access to water jet cutters, and you needed to have access to fancy mills. And so now, I want to think about what is the lowest common denominator that people have access to. So lots of people have access to FDM 3D printers. They're everywhere now. And they're not necessarily great, but maybe you can, instead of saying, we're going to rely on a 3-ton granite block for precise alignment that's really flat, we're going to take advantage of other clever alignment techniques. Anyone work on optics and lasers and stuff? You guys familiar with Maxwell couplings? I really don't know this audience. So you have a body in space. How many degrees of freedom does it have? Six. Yes, six. So you can move in X, you can move in Y, you can move in Z, and then there's roll, pitch, and yaw. So you have 6 degrees of freedom. Now, how many points of contact do you need to constrain six degrees of freedom? Six. And so if you want, for example, something, if you have one point of contact, it can still do all kinds of things. You have two points of contact, you can start maybe restricting degrees of freedom. So if you want to fully constrain a body in space, you need exactly 6 points of contact. The Maxwell coupling is a coupling where you have three slots and three spheres. So when you touch the three spheres to the three slots, you have exactly 6 degrees of freedom. So as you couple something, it's always going to end up in exactly the same place if you use a Maxwell coupling, which is well known by optics people. Like you can buy a lot of Maxwell coupled devices from Thor Labs. But it's not necessarily used extensively in other kinds of parts. But there's no reason why you wouldn't be able to make a Maxwell coupling with off-the-shelf screws, structures that are 3D printed, and the ball and ball screws. So if you think about fabricability, you can say, OK, we're going to make all of this on crappy 3D printers. But that doesn't necessarily mean that you need a loss of precision. But you do need to be careful about what the mechanisms are that you're designing into your systems. And maybe you can take advantage of clever error-correcting geometries to be able to have precision in your final parts. When you design things for fabricability, you're not necessarily working with people who are going to be doing the same thing over and over again. So if you design a part that is rotationally symmetrical, or it looks like it's rotationally symmetrical, but it's not, you're going to get a lot of error in assembly. And so one of the things that we've been experimenting with is, how do you make sure that all of the different parts that you design can't easily be misconstrued for each other? And what is the level of documentation that is required for people who aren't actually experts in this, but still want to be able to have access to the same kind of infrastructure? It turns out that the amount of documentation that's sufficient for someone else in your field is not nearly good enough for someone who has never done something like that before. And that understanding what other people know is actually very difficult for people who design hardware. If you guys designed a circuit, what would you think would be like sufficient source material? I think that I've seen a lot of open source projects where they just release schematics as JPEGs. What am I going to do with that? And so how much documentation do you need to provide to make sure that the people who you're trying to serve with your open source hardware can actually do it? And then I think that tools are a big part of that. The tools for this Maxwell coupling, you want to be able to push in these steel posts into your FDM 3D printed part, but these are at 120 degrees, so how do you get it into your arbor press in such a way that you can actually press it in correctly? You can't just hold it awkwardly, but it's very easy to 3D print a fixture that's going to hold your part in exactly the right alignment as you press in the pin. So maybe it's not just saying you need access to a 3D printer and a laser cutter, but as you design the parts that you want people to reproduce, you also have to make sure you give them all of the other things that help you with that. What are the fixturing, what are the fixturing tools that you can design that are really inexpensive and easy to make that come along with that kind of documentation? So this is Jubilee. Jubilee is another fabricatable machine, but this one in particular is focused on doing different kinds of workflows. One thing that's the case for many digital fabrication machines is they all use G-code. Who's used G-code? Yes, at least a few of you have used G-code. How old do you think G-code is? When's the last revision to G-code? 20 years ago? No, that would be like 1999. It's much more than that. It's more like 50. So G-code hasn't actually changed in a long time. And for those of you who have never used G-code, G-code is a simple programming language that has conditionals that no one ever uses and mostly is used for tasks like move to X position this and Y position this and Z position this. So for a 3D printer, you're like moving around in space and doing different things. And if you, the coil winding machine, you could program something like that in G code by saying you have to move back and forth and then move out and then move back and forth. But you quickly get to limitations for certain kinds of workflows where you might need more than just position. You might need to specify some amount of force, or you might need to specify a temperature, or you might need to you might want to specify something like shake this petri dish until yeast starts to grow and then start doing something. So what are ways in which other kinds of workflows might need precision, and how do you program those? That's something I think is not actually well established in these small volume machines. People think of 3D printers as the new Star Trek replicator. What about all of the things that are polished? What about all of the things that require some kind of post-processing? So Jubilee is a machine that is fabricatable, so everything is either made on low-cost 3D printer or available as off-the-shelf parts. And it can switch its tools to pick up different things. So here, here's the aforementioned Maxwell coupling. So here's how Jubilee picks up and locks a tool into place. And this is a USB microscope, so that you can make something, and then you can say you do some 3D printing, and then you go back and inspect it with your microscope. The bed plate of Jubilee also takes advantage of the Maxwell coupling, so you can place it in and take it out. Useful reasons why you might want to swap out a bed is, for example, maybe you want to put the whole thing in a reflow oven for a while, or maybe you want to sandblast the parts that you just produced, or maybe you just want to do some kind of high throughput production where you have multiple beds. What you don't then want to do is every time you change the bed to have to re-zero your tool and put something else on it. So here, we're borrowing from the programming language principles, separation of concerns, where every time you have a tool that might work with a bed, you can remove all of that and reuse the motion platform of Jubilee for different kinds of tools, but make sure that you have the functionality encapsulated in a way that allows for reconfigurability. So here you could also take the bed plate and put it into the next machine. Here I'll just show you it picking up and dropping off other tools. The process of picking up and dropping off, oh no, this is just the plotting one. Here I'll pick up and drop off a different tool. The process of picking up and dropping off tools has to do with parking and specifying which tool is in which place. And picking up different tools is something that's relatively standard in high-end machining centers. So you could use a rapid clearing end mill and then a chamfering end mill. But it's not necessarily standard for these kinds of desktop tools, because I posit that up until now, it hasn't been that easy necessarily to get access to the precision that you would need to be able to reliably go back to the same place. And I think that that's just a limitation of clever designs. This is a liquid handling. These are liquid handling tools, so they have syringes with peristaltic pumps. How do you program the peristaltic pump to do exactly what you want? This is it as a, oh, whoops. This is it pipetting a gradient in a 96 well plate. One space where I feel like automation is really underexplored is in biology experiments and chemistry experiments that aren't high throughput. How do you allow for people who just have like a short, simple idea of something that they want to test with, but programming that experiment takes a lot of time. So I'm interested not just in digital fabricability, but also in the possibilities of precision in different kinds of workflows. And if you want to build, this machine, we are currently actively supporting it. You could join our Discord where everybody's talking about the different build processes for Jubilee. And that, I think, is also a really important component of open source hardware and reusable infrastructure. It can often seem like it's all about the thing and not about the community, but without a community of practice, you're not able to necessarily disseminate best practices. And so where are things like this happening? How do you share information about distributed production? And where do you find reliable contract manufacturers for the parts that you can't make? And what are the different names of the parts that you need? I think that between, you know, YouTube maker celebrities, Discord channels, and other kinds of TV shows, things are really pretty exciting right now. If you aren't slacking off by doing stuff like this, you should. My lab is in Fluke, so come visit us anytime. Here are two of my PhD students, Joshua and Hannah, who've been working a lot on Jubilee. And that's really all I wanted to talk to you about. And I will take any questions you have for the next 10-ish minutes, I think. Didn't want to guess about G-code, also don't want to ask questions. Who's been to Shenzhen? Only one person? But it's so fun.
So can you say a little more about how that Maxwell coupling works? I mean, you sort of described it, and then there were pictures, but I couldn't sort of see very well.
So here you can see these balls. There are screws that are screwed into this. And then here you have the slots. And so basically one slot touches one ball. And then there has to be some kind of, so that's just the making sure it ends up in the right place. Then you need to have some kind of mating force where it has to like stay together, which you can do with a screw. But for quick release, we're using this T slot. Basically, this fits into here, and the opposite side of this plate is graded. So as you tighten it, it locks into position. Do you guys know what a series elastic actuator is? We're just going to use. Yeah, I bet you do. So if you have an actuator that has a spring in series, it's called a series elastic actuator. And there you can. You guys use torque wrenches. Simple torques. Okay, so this. So when you use a torque wrench, the spring constant of the spring that's in the torque wrench helps you figure out exactly how much force you're tightening to. And so for this lock mechanism, you have a graded surface. So this pin is being moved up a graded surface, and the spring that you're tightening then will touch an end stop after you've tightened it enough, and that means that the position isn't determining whether or not it's locked, but the amount of torque is determining whether or not it's locked. And so for applications where you need a specific amount of force applied rather than a particular position, series elastic actuators is a useful way to go. You see a lot of it in like robotics, but they don't necessarily all need to be extremely expensive. You can just do it with a little piece of spring and some fishing wire.
So for this setup, is the precision limited by the distance between the balls and then?
The precision for something like this is really limited by whether or not this surface is imprecise and wearing. So you really want exactly one point of contact, but obviously that's never really the case. You're always going to get some amount of space that's touching. And so there, you might, especially as these surfaces start to wear, you might lose precision, which is why these are steel, whereas the rest of the structure is made out of PLA. But the repeatability that you get with a Maxwell coupling is, you know, it's order tens of microns, not what you would get from just like manually aligning something. So the precision and accuracy that you get from a system like this is really much better than any alternative.
And even though it's made on this 3D printer that doesn't have a lot of precision,
yes,
at least the repeatability.
Right, exactly. And the first time you install the tool, you do need to zero it. So the first time, so say we have this microscope and we want to know where the bottom of the microscope is with relation to the bed, that's something that we do have to set once. But once you set it, every time you pick it up, it will always be the same.
So you're kind of hitting on this, but like, do you do anything in your lab with respect to like durability? Like,
yes.
So you can do like 100 prints and then you have to retighten all the bolts or?
Yeah. So we do fatigue testing. We have successfully picked up and dropped off these tools 20,000 times without any change in positioning or without any measurable change for us, at least in positioning. But eventually this plate is designed to wear out. As you tighten the steel thing onto a plastic plate, that will wear out, which is why you can remove it and replace it. But because it's torque locked and not position locked, it doesn't really matter. At some point, it will just stop being able to be locked at all. It'll throw an error, and then you replace this little triangle. I think that durability, though, with a lot of mechanical engineers that work on machine design, they're really going to talk about very specific kinds of durability. Like, they're going to talk about how you need a lot of inertia matching and like everything needs to be optimal in a certain way. And that does matter if you're trying to do really, really fast, high throughput applications. But if you just want to like do something precisely 100 times, I don't really think it matters that you're going to use a lead screw, which is not super well impedance matched to your application. Like, just, yes, you're only pushing 20 grams and you could be pushing 20 kilos, but who cares? Yeah?
How much time and money would it cost to make one of the Jubilee?
The Jubilee machine bill of materials is right now around $1,700. And then how much time it would take you kind of depends on your comfort maybe with some of them, but I would say that, say you had very little expertise, maybe 24 hours that you might want to spread over several days. But yeah, if you're interested, you should come by and talk to us about it, because we would love to help you and then study how you get frustrated to change our design. Yeah, right now I think around 50 people are actively building it that we're monitoring in the Discord channel. And because of all of the people who are actively building it, there are certain things that are becoming like maybe more convenient. So instead of this is something that you would have to assemble yourself, and then you'd need to have an arbor press, you'd have to do a lot of precise alignment. And some people decided that that was not something that they all wanted to do on their own, so they got together and made it into a custom part, which you can now buy off of a Timdi store. So the target timeline is changing. Yeah.
So you mentioned error correction at one point. Can you say a little more about your thoughts on that?
On error correction,
how
yeah.
How do ideas of error correction apply to this kind of thing?
Yeah, so one thing that's always difficult when you're trying to get people to make precise things is that they have to be able to measure whether or not they're precise. And if you don't know how to measure if something is square, then it's going to be really difficult to make sure that it is square, because the person who's assembling it doesn't necessarily know how to make the measurement. So instead of relying on the assembler to do it, you can rely on clever geometries like Lego. Lego is built by imprecise people, children, and yet Lego itself is very precise. Like, you have micron precision with one block fitting on top of another, because all Lego parts, even though you can't really tell, are tapered in a certain way, and there's flexures inside the bricks. So as you position it, it will end up moving to the right place, and you end up with a part in the right place. And so using that kind of design for open source hardware, where you're doing something that's error correcting, like a backpack strap too, if you buckle, the backpack buckle has something that helps you align the system. So how do you make sure that instead of relying on expertise of the person assembling the machine, how do you rely on clever geometries that help with the assembly? Sometimes that means that it will take more time to machine. Like, machining a whole buckle is more work than saying, here's a hole and put a screw in. But if the screw is going to cause misalignment in plane, and that is going to cause your machine not to work at all, then that, of course, is worse. Yeah?
Besides the little triangle there that just gets worn sometimes, are there any other pieces that you need to replace regularly?
Yeah, so Jubilee, I didn't really get into this, but you can see maybe here best, that there is a timing belt. The XY uses a timing belt, and that probably eventually might need to get replaced because it stretches. But this is not necessarily meant to be like a 100,000-year machine, where as opposed to maybe the Cincinnati Hydrotel milling machine that I imagine 500 years from now, you'll unearth one somewhere in a building and it will look exactly the same as it did in 1952. This one is made out of PLA, so PLA degrade, like it has a lifetime. The PLA will turn brittle and degrade. And so I would say there's a lot of things that are designed to make it repeatable in its use, so while it's being used, but I wouldn't necessarily say that this is a machine that has been designed to outlast if it was just sitting around. Yeah, after maybe 10 years, you would want to reprint all of the parts. Yeah.
Okay, so I mean, like a lot of these machines look like they rely on an advanced industrial economy.
Yes.
You know, in order for people to have like, you know, not
yes.
only like the materials, but also the leisure time.
Yes.
To put these kind of things together. Like, do you see these kind of things being able to help people who are in developing economies to, and you know, is there a place for automation in that?
Yeah, so marketplaces, I think, are good. I think that one thing that was a limitation a long time ago was you didn't have access to marketplaces. So I, as an individual who wanted to buy small amounts of aluminum extrusion, could not do so. And that has changed. And that's not different from different countries to each other. So one of the instances of this machine I built in Egypt, it's not necessarily the most remote place, but it is definitely a completely different supply chain that you have access to. And there, you also have access to these parts. I think that it's something that maybe we in universities can take for granted, because we just buy stuff from McMaster Car and expect that everyone has access to that kind of precision. But I do think that that has changed, and that now who gets to participate in these marketplaces, and what is the level of granularity that you need, the level of granularity that the marketplace provides, those things have really changed, especially for machines. And I think that you could argue, I think it's really a spurious argument to say, do people in developing places need access to precision? I mean, of course they do. You need to have, if you wanted to do things like medical diagnostics, you need to have that kind of reliability. And what you also need is repairability and the ability to customize something to whatever the environment that you're operating in is. Like not being able to change out a power supply or a different kind of connector is something that I think is inherently limiting. And so, yes, it absolutely relies on like a well-developed, robust industrial economy and marketplace. But that's something that I would say you now have global access to in very small volumes. And that taking advantage of that is a, the kind of project that I really don't like is let's make a dumber, smaller version of this and say that that's good for developing economies. What I'm much more interested in is how do you create infrastructure that is customizable without necessarily making that many assumptions about what you would need to customize it for, but building those kinds of things into the infrastructure at the get-go and making sure that people have access to the tools and knowledge to take advantage of that infrastructure.
Probably wrap it up there. Thank you very much.